And it is my great pleasure also to bring Jeb Payton. And one thing to tell you before I leave the stage, because I think this is not a moment for me to stay here, is that Jeb Payton is tonight having his debut with Jessye Norman. And finally, as I leave you in the company of the resplendent Jessye Norman, you know that for the last couple of years, I've asked various people who have come to this stage, the extraordinary talent we have the opportunity of bringing here, to give me a biography of themselves in 7 words, a haiku of sort. I think Gilberto Gil gave me 9 words. Jessye Norman was more obedient. And she gave me 7 words a few moments ago, and I would like to read them in the order she delivered them. Curious, busy, engaged, focused, joy-filled, human, God-loving. Jessye Norman.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Jeb Payton and I are delighted to be with you and to bring you 3 songs. Harold Arlen, Sleepin' Bee. Duke Ellington, Solitude. George Gershwin, I've Got Rhythm.
You'll see a sun up sky.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you, darling. Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you. And now for something totally different. That too. Who could ask for anything more? I've got some of that. I've got all of that. Who could ask for anything more? Old man trouble, I don't mind him. You won't find him hanging around my door. I've got sky. We don't know anything else. Thank you very much. Now let me see if I know how this works. Okay. Thank you, Jeb Patton. Good evening, everyone. We're so delighted to be here with you. I would like to speak for a few moments about art. Big A-R-T. You are no doubt filled with your own knowledge of the importance of art in our lives. Give me just a moment of your time, as I find we are too often treated as though work with our bodies were less important than work with our minds, or our heads more important than our hearts. If you and I had been sitting here in an era other than this wildly modern one, we would rest on chairs or stools made by hand, each one a little different from the other, each one a unique expression of human creativity. We would wear woven clothing and carved jewelry that would be a part of a communal tradition, yet individually unique. We would celebrate with food and drink that would be creations in themselves, taken from vessels that would be objects of art, as well as utensils for everyday use. We would surely be singing and dancing together. We would be living artfully without trying. Albert Einstein, and I love this quotation, stated, quote, "When I examine myself and my method of thought, I come to the conclusion that the gift of fantasy has meant more to me than my talent for absorbing knowledge." The gift of fantasy, unquote. Creativity. Now, if Einstein felt this way, I would encourage all of us to raise our hands to the sky and rejoice in our own creative spirits. Creativity equals self-knowledge. This knowledge can lead to wisdom, and wisdom to the understanding of others. And this understanding undoubtedly leads to tolerance. My point here is that your understanding of and your practice of any form of artistic expression makes you qualified more than some to help to lead this world out of its malaise. Celebrate your art, celebrate its wisdom, celebrate all that is possible, because art lives. Education in the arts for our children is not only desired, it is essential. We who support our communities and thereby our school systems are remiss in allowing arts education to simply fall away from the school's curriculum. Yes, we are remiss. We owe it to our children, this education in the arts, all children. We have to do better. Art brings us, all of us, together as a family because it is an individual expression of universal human experience. It comes from that part of us that is without fear, prejudice, malice, or any of the other things that we create in order to separate ourselves one from the other. Art makes each of us whole by insisting that we use all of our senses, our heads and our hearts, that we express with our bodies, our voices, our hands, as well as with our minds. In Arthur O'Shaughnessy's single poem, which he called Ode, he wrote in praise of artists everywhere, quote, "We are the music makers, and we are the dreamers of dreams, wandering by lone sea breakers and sitting by desolate streams on whom the pale moon gleams. Yet, we are the movers and shakers of the world forever, it seems." Unquote. What a thought. Creative spirits, the movers and shakers of the world. Where could all this lead? We might come across the notion that an awakened spirit, this ability to express ourselves through these individual offerings, could well be the real meaning of life. That the exploration of our own imagination might be our real life's work. Please listen to the words by an unknown author that arrived in my mailbox recently, and which I offer to you as a kind of watchword for this beautiful weekend devoted to all that art can be, can do, all that art is. Quote, "On the surface of the world right now, there is war and violence, and things seem dark. But calmly and quietly, at the same time, something else is happening. Underground, an inner revolution is taking place, and certain ones of us are being called to a higher light. It is a silent revolution from the inside out. We are slowly creating a new world with the power of our minds and hearts. We follow with passion and joy our spiritual intelligence. We are dropping soft love bombs when no one is looking. Poems, hugs, music, photography, movies, kind words, smiles, dance, beautiful graphic art, random acts of kindness. We each express ourselves in our own ways, with our own gifts and talents. Yes, be the change that you want to see in this world. This is our motto that fills our hearts. We know it is the only way to real transformation. We know that quietly and humbly, we have the power of all the oceans combined. Our work is slow and meticulous, like the formation of the mountains. And yet, with this opening of the spirit self, entire tectonic plates shall be moved in the decades to come. Entire tectonic plates. This intelligence of the heart is embedded in the timeless evolutionary pulse of all human beings. Be the change you want to see in this world. No one can do it for you. The door is open. All are welcome." Unquote. Now, is that not something to find in your email inbox? The point of that wonderful message and my charge to you this evening is that our world is in need of you. In need of the compassion that a practice in the arts can well help to develop, and that we must reach out to one another with arms outstretched to all comers. The malaise is ours to correct. I ask you to offer the teachings of your hearts and minds, the fullness of art, the true music of your soul, and imagine, if you will, the harmony this could bring to our world. Thank you. Thank you. Okay.
I think it was okay.
Thank you.
I think it was very good, and I think we should talk about that.
Okay,
first.
Let's talk about that.
I think you're a woman on a mission, are you not?
Yes.
Arts education matters to you so very much that you felt the need to open a school.
To open a school in the town in which I was born, Augusta, Georgia. I'm very lucky to have a wonderful board of directors and wonderful people who do the day-to-day work at this school. and we take children at their most vulnerable and their most difficult age, middle school age.
That's 12.
11 to about 15.
Oh dear.
And yes.
Having a 9-year-old, I'm fearful.
Yes. Coming in thinking that, gee whiz, I passed the audition and I get to go to this school tuition free, but you know, what's it going to be like? I mean, am I really going to learn anything? And they come in walking, sometimes looking at the floor. And I go back in 6 weeks and they say, hello, Miss Norman, I'm a writer. My name is Louise Miller. And I say, well, I'm so glad to know about you, Louise. And I will tell Edward Albee to pull his socks up because you're on your way. And they are so full of joy once they understand what it is that the school is offering them, which is a way into their own spirits, a way into self-discovery. And they feel, and they can show, of course, in their auditions, which we do have, and we also have agreements and contracts with their parents that mean that they must rehearse and practice whatever it is they're studying with us at home as well. And the parents are very happy to be involved, and it helps us so, so much. And they change practically before your eyes.
The parents sign what?
They sign a contract that the children, whatever it is they're studying with us, whether it's a single instrument or group singing or dancing or writing or art or pottery or whatever it is, that they will also practice at home. So that when they come to us, because they go to regular school, as it were, and they come to us after school for 3.5 hours every day. And they are so talented, some of them. It just makes me weep when I see some of them with these marvelous voices, and they're 13, 14 years old. And I just hope that they're going to be all right, and that they won't be exploited, and that that voice will still be in that body at age 25, and not having been ruined by an overzealous somebody or the other. And that is probably, particularly for the young little singer people, the singers, that's always my worry, that they will be exploited and the voice will disappear. Because voices, unlike sort of other instruments, if we abuse them, the vocal cords are probably some of the least forgiving parts of our body. If we abuse that instrument, and if we do not learn how to support that sound that we like to make, if we do not understand what the diaphragm is or what the xiphoid process does or how the lungs are meant to expand and all of that sort of thing, and we put sort of emphasis on this and sort of our chins are held a certain way and all the rest of it, it is unforgiving. These muscles are for chewing. They will give way and your voice will shake and it will sound like that. And that can happen very early on. It doesn't have to wait until you're sort of 95.
But for every age, there is a certain kind of music one should sing, a certain
For every age, there is a certain, I think I would say, I don't know if I would say kind. Let me think of a word. I would say that for every age, there is appropriate music to sing. And that a 13-year-old Madame Butterfly could be very interesting, but she won't be an 18-year-old Madame Butterfly. And that is what I find really very distressing.
At the same time, a 25-year-old Madame Butterfly.
In the right house, with the good conductor, with an orchestra that knows what you mean when you do this, so that, because let me, I don't want to get too technical here, but in Puccini, a great deal of the time, as the singers in the audience will know, very often what you're singing is also being played by the violins or some other instrument in the orchestra, which means that your voice is being doubled by something. And if your voice is not sufficiently prepared, therefore meaning you've had enough training and enough experience to cope with that, you can compete with the orchestra rather than being carried by it.
But I'm also interested by a 25-year-old Madame Butterfly as opposed to a 45-year-old Madame Butterfly who might understand something very different about Madame Butterfly.
Yes.
And the relationship between age and taste, between age and understanding, between reading a book, if one goes in that direction, when one is younger than some of the protagonists, and rereading it when one is older than they are.
Of course. You're going to bring more of your own life to this. Whether if you're 25 and lucky enough to sing in the right circumstances, this particular opera that we've mentioned, that could be a wonderful experience. And if you're very lucky to still be sort of doing this at age 45, you will have so much more of your own life experience to bring to that role. And it is a tragic role for those of you who know that particular opera, Madame Butterfly. It does not end happily. And there are so many instances where the character might be described as a very, very young person. And there is a tendency, and I understand it, to have a very, very young person to do that particular role, but it is not very good for that very young person.
What you were saying earlier about the frailty of the voice.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, there's such examples of it, no? That Anna Moffo, I mean, there's so many examples of singers who, I mean, you were talking earlier about the fear you have in your school that some of these children may be used too much.
They certainly won't be used too much at our school,
because we.
But if they're heard by whomever, and somebody says, "Oh yes, well you must come and do this particular role, and we'll take you off Broadway or whatever that kind of thing," it's tempting and it's wonderful, and you want them to have wonderful success, but we want them to be ready and prepared for it.
So one of the things your school tries to teach the students is say no.
Patience, to understand that in the arts, that doing something over and over again in a rehearsal space is a very good practice, so that when the occasion arrives that you might be able to do that in front of an audience, you're absolutely ready to do it. And we try to teach that it is important to understand that practice is necessary.
And there are no shortcuts.
And that there are no shortcuts. And this whole idea of these horrible reality shows.
I like how you say that.
If you just... I'm sorry. I blame television for everything that is wrong in the world. So
well,
you will have to forgive me.
It makes it simple. At least there's one place.
Yes, but children somehow gather the idea that they just sort of sing loudly enough and for the right person, that they'll have a recording contract that night and they'll be famous next week.
If that long.
Which could happen, but then, you know, what about the week after that?
Because this sentence matters to you so much, I'd like to repeat it.
Yes.
And for you to expand a little bit more on this quotation that I do love also, the Albert Einstein quotation,
yes,
where the gift of fantasy has meant more to me than my talent for absorbing positive knowledge.
Yes. And I think that when one realizes and understands and knows about the brain of Albert Einstein, that he would feel that the possibility of going into your own mind on exploration was somehow more important than all of the knowledge that he had. I mean, when you think of the knowledge that he had and the knowledge that he imparted to us, and there was probably a lot more that he never got around to writing or saying, but when one imagines that a person of that depth of thought would say to us that positive fantasy is the way to go. It's rather wonderful.
But do
it's
you think really it is partly because he believed in fantasy that he was able to become so deep, in some sense, that the possibility of imagining other realities, of empathy,
of course.
Putting yourself in somebody else's shoes, however uncomfortable they may be.
Absolutely. I'm trying to think, I want to get this straight. Maybe somebody in the audience can help me with another quote from Einstein. He said something like, if at first an idea is not seen as ridiculous, there is no hope for it. And I think that that is wonderful. If it doesn't seem as though it is completely incredible and has no merit whatsoever, then there's no hope that it can ever be. And I think that that is wonderful. I really love that.
I do too. I'm wondering why I love it. Can you repeat it one more time?
Yes, I'm sure that I'm not using exactly the right words, but he said something like, if at first an idea is not thought to be ridiculous, there is no hope for it. That a new idea has to seem quite unbelievable. I mean, when you think about Steve Jobs saying that he would create what he was able to create, it had to have seemed to the people to whom he first spoke, what is he talking about? The inter what? The tablet for what? It will be able to do what? Are you kidding? We can hardly get the telephone to work properly. But I'm sure at first the idea must have seemed incredible. I have a story of friends of mine, they tell this on themselves, that long time ago, not that long ago, they were approached by a young man called Bill Gates. And he said that he was working on something in his garage, we say in this country, sorry. And that he needed some financial support to get it going. And he explained to them what it was he was thinking about doing. And they said, you can't be serious. And they unfortunately didn't invest. They tell this story on themselves.
Why those three pieces of music to start out with? Because you sent them to me in advance. And I can't figure it out quite.
Well, it doesn't have any sort of meaning other than I happen to love them. I mean, there's so many songs that I love, but you know, you have to sort of choose, and you can't sort of sing everything you love every night. We would be here for quite a few days. But I sing a lot of American music in Europe, and I talk about the composers, and I talk about the people that have made some of these songs famous. And I talk about them because I wish to point out that outside, even taken away from the context, taken out of the musical, and simply presented as a song on stage in a recital, that these composers were wonderful composers. And that they have merit. And I love being in Vienna. And someone is asking me about, what is it about Duke Ellington that you find so fascinating? And I love to say that Duke Ellington said something that I think is really very, very clever. He said, there are only two kinds of music, good music and that other kind.
Which reminded me of the preface of Dorian Gray, where he says, books are well written or badly written. That's all.
That's all.
That's all.
I quite
End
agree.
End of story.
End of story.
End of story.
Absolutely.
Now, let's go to some of the music that was so important to you. I'd like to start by surprising you with track number 7.
Aha.
Love was ours until October wandered by. Let the years come and go, I'll still feel the glow that time cannot fade when I hear that lovely
Oh, let's listen to the rest of it.
You were really getting into it. Huh?
Well, Autumn Serenade.
Yeah. Coltrane matters greatly to you. I don't know if Hartman does. I imagine he does.
Yes, of course. But all of them matter greatly to me. One of the most enlightening things that I think I experienced was preparing over a period of more than 2.5 years a festival that happened under the guidance and sponsorship and everything of Carnegie Hall 2 years ago that Honor. We called Honor. And in researching what had happened on the stage at Carnegie Hall, I first of all was so pleased, and my heart simply sang, understanding that Carnegie Hall opened its doors in 1891, and that on that stage in 1892, an African-American soprano was singing on that stage, unlike a lot of other places where African-Americans were not welcomed. At Carnegie Hall, Sister Zaretta Jones was on stage singing music from Traviata. It happens that she was a friend of Harry T. Burley, wonderful composer, marvelous arranger of African-American spirituals, and that Harry T. Burley was a friend of Anton Dvorak, who by that time had come and was looking at the New World and writing that lovely Symphony No. 9 that we love so much. And In my research, I spent so much time listening to the music of all of these wonderful singers, jazz singers, pop singers, classical singers, of course, all kinds of other musicians that had performed over this incredibly long period, 120 years now, at Carnegie Hall. And I said to myself, now, why in the world don't you sing this music more? This is really quite silly. And so I decided then and there, okay, we're going to do American music for a while now. We've done a great deal of Strauss and Berlioz and Schubert and everybody else. Let's talk a bit about the music that Odetta sang. Let's talk about what a beautiful voice and a beautiful being Lena Horne was. Let's talk about Josephine Baker and the decision to leave the United States and to perform in France, where she was welcomed and beloved even to this day. All I have to do is walk out on stage and say that I'm going to sing J'ai deux amours, and you know, I don't need to sing it. Everybody knows it, and everybody is so in love with it.
Maybe not everybody here does. How does it go?
J'ai deux amours, mon pays et Paris, parle toujours, mon cœur est ravi, ta savoir n'est belle, mais à quoi bon le nier, ce qui m'en sorcelle, c'est Paris, Paris tout entier, pour voir un jour, c'est mon rêve joli, j'ai deux amours, mon pays et Paris. Thank you.
I mean.
That was a trick.
It was a trick. and it's not the only one.
It is not the only one. You got more.
I got more tricks up my sleeve. But of course, the French would love that.
Yes, I mean, of
and
course.
Of course, the Parisians would be. J'ai deux amours, I have two loves.
Yes, I have
my
two
country
loves,
and
my country
France,
and Paris.
I mean, please, can you imagine?
Oh, It works.
Could we look at the clip, the video clip, the A clip? What did it feel like to be draped in the French flag?
Well, I kept saying, well, I'm American.
American and you're African-American.
Yes.
And this was an important point.
This was an important point. And it was a point that President Mitterrand wanted to make. But I wanted to be sure. And it was 1 year before the bicentennial, and someone from the president's office, I was making a recording in Paris at the time, said that he needed to meet with me, and I didn't know what that meant exactly. But I did meet with this person, and he said that for next year, for the bicentenary, the president would like you to sing the Marseillaise. And I said, where? And he said, and the défilé, at the parade. And so I said, okay. And then he was called Monsieur du Pavillon. And I said, well, of course, I would be honored. However this is meant to happen, it would certainly be a great honor to do this. And before he left the room, I said, Monsieur du Pavillon, I just want to make sure that you understand that I'm African-American and that I'm not from Guadeloupe or Martinique or Haiti or anywhere.
Because if you do believe that...
Because I spend so much time sort of singing in France, I just want to make sure that we were very clear. And so he said, no, the president knows what he's doing. I said, well, of course. And it was quite unbelievable. I mean, there we all were working on this. And when I think about it, none of the people working on the dress or getting ready for this were French. Jean-Paul Gould is French-American. His mother is American. And Azdina Laya, who created the dress, is Tunisian. And I was American. There we are, sort of putting this thing together. I thought it was quite wonderful, and it really gave true meaning for once. It gave true meaning for this idea of fraternité, égalité, because it really is what is meant by the Marseillaise and the meaning of all of this, these tricolores, the three colors. And it still has great, great meaning for me. It's really quite unbelievable when you consider this was 20 years ago. And I'm not kidding when I say to you that at least still, after all this time, at least once a week, at least once a week, I will meet someone who will say, I was on the Champs-Élysées when you sang the Marseillaise. I said, by now I've met all million people that were standing there. But it really is quite amazing. And it's very seldom that I've seen this videotape.
How does it feel to I'm curious about that.
Well,
to
see you. It feels like I'm looking at someone else.
Really?
Well, because I remember it all so well. It's kind of amazing. Monsieur de Pavillon, this wonderful person who worked with the president, was in. They had created a dressing room for me, and quite near the obelisk at the Place de la Concorde, where this all took place. And so I could see on a television monitor screen all of the parade that happened before the ending when I was going to sing. So I just wasn't sort of, you know, sitting in a room with nothing to sort of watch. And Monsieur de Pavillon was with me. And unlike a lot of these things, at sort of the openings of this and the closings of that, very often singers are singing to playback, which means that actually it's already recorded and you're sort of mouthing the words. This was live. And Monsieur de Pavillon came to me and he said, in French, are you nervous? And so I said, no. He said, it's not normal. 3 billion people around the world are going to be watching you sing in French. I said, Monsieur de Pavillon, I believe in practice. I believe in rehearsing. You can pinch me at any time of day and out will come all of the text for La Marseillaise, I promise you. Do not worry, this will be fine.
And in a sense, this leads me to something you have said early on, that music was always in my life. I'm told that I started to sing at about the same time that I started to speak.
Yes, that's what my parents have told me, yes. And that, as a child, sometimes I would sing what it was I wanted rather than to speak it. So I have no memory of not trying to sing. I have no memory of that.
And you were brought up, we were talking a little bit earlier, you mentioned your hometown.
Yes.
Which was so important to you, where I'd like you to bring us to back to Mount Calvary Baptist Church Choir and to your sister now. But before we do, let's just listen for a minute to track 5.
No one praying in the chapel where get rusty down the care anymore. Rusty bell, rusty bell. All your people back again. Call him back.
What a voice. Mahalia Jackson, my goodness. What a singer. Imagine making that quality and that amazing noise with no training whatsoever. Not in the sense that we think about vocal training.
And she
did it all her life. She could sing until she passed.
And she was very, very important to you. I mean,
important in that she was such an amazingly simple person. I mean that in the best sense of the word. She was an uncomplicated human being.
Humble,
yes. And very respectful of what she considered, and it was, her gift. And I know a lot of people who knew her very well. I did not know her personally, but I know a lot of people who were very close to her, and it was apparently a remarkable thing just to be around her. And how she would, they say, gather herself together when it was time for her to perform. It was as though she were calling in all of what nature can provide, and then she would simply give it out again.
I'm so taken by these early stories of what forms us. Yesterday with Gilberto Gil, we were talking about early stories when he was two and a half, three years old. The music again, as seems to be so often the case, that one's mother, it seems that the importance of the mother is never overstated.
Precisely. Well, my mother and her three of her sisters had a little group, and they were all sort of very young, sort of school teachers, and they were not yet married. And they had a little group, and they went around sort of, you know, from church to church sort of singing. And apparently they were quite good. I'm sorry, I never actually heard them. And of course, isn't it awful that there are no recordings of this kind of thing? But I spent a lot of time listening to my mother singing.
Sing.
And also my grandmother. And as I always say, I could tell the mood. I always say this because it's so true. And we kid about it a great deal now with my siblings. We could always tell grandmother's mood by the song she sang. Because if she were feeling sort of happy and everything was going along, of course, it was a very happy song. And if she was really concerned about something, it was more mournful. And it was very interesting to be around this kind of thing as a very, very young child. Because, of course, you can't articulate what it is you're thinking and feeling or taking in the same way.
And no wonder, in a sense, that when you tried to articulate some things early on, you would do it in song.
Yes, because it was simply easier.
And your mother told you early on to pay attention to one particular singer. And look at one particular movie that she said, you know, just come here. Very similar story once again to the kinds of stories you were talking about yesterday.
Yes.
Or for that matter, when Harry Belafonte came here and said, you know, how incredibly important Paul Robeson was
him.
Yes. But for you, the person who mattered at that moment, you were 11, I think, 10
yes,
or 11
about
or 12.
Yes, 10 or 11, Marian Anderson. The film was The Lady from Philadelphia. And as any 10 or 11-year-old, I was out in the garden playing with friends. And my mother said, come in and dust yourself off. There's something on television that you have to see. And I thought, oh, well. And it was Marian Anderson. That stately, beautiful, majestic, graceful Marian Anderson. And at about that time, her biography was available. And I read it, and there were parts of it that made me very sad. Because, of course, she was completely, in the time when she was performing, there were all kinds of obstacles unimaginable in the way of this. Once in a, I don't know, I think it was Toscanini who said it was once in 100 years, but I think it takes even more years before one has another voice quite like that. But I later on had the privilege, that's all that I can say, of being able to spend a little time with her. Those were truly golden moments, to be able to say, well, tell me about the time that you sang for the King of Norway and how that all went and all the rest of it. And she was always, and I always say this, she was always so kind. She wanted to know what I was doing, and I didn't want to talk about that. I wanted to know about her.
I feel the same way. I want to know more.
You know? That's very sweet. But she was so kind and so welcoming. And I would come back from a trip or something and ring up the assistant to say, is it a good day? May I drop by? And she would say, well, yes, if you come about 5 o'clock, that should be good. And it was just, I treasure those moments. I cannot tell you.
What, when you came in from the garden and saw the film, what music of hers did you hear her sing first?
The first thing that I heard her sing, I had already heard her sing, because I had heard the Alto Rhapsody of Brahms that she recorded with Munch in about 1937 or something like that. I'm sure somebody can look up that and tell us exactly the date. And I remember listening to that recording, and I said at the time, I was about 9 or 10 years old, is that just a voice? There's nothing else there? That's a woman singing? Is that even possible? And so I had her already in my mind at the time that I was called in to sort of watch the film. And it was, and it still is something that absolutely stays with me. I know what her voice sounds like in the Brahms Alto Rhapsody, but the first thing that I heard her sing on that film was, My Country, 'Tis of Thee, Sweet Land of Liberty, of Thee I Sing. And that was from Easter Sunday, Washington, D.C., the Lincoln Memorial, 1939, Eleanor Roosevelt had gotten together with the Department of Interior, and she'd had a word with her husband, I would imagine. And as Marian Anderson had been denied the right, and there were all kinds of stories, but the truth is she was denied the right to sing on the stage of Constitution Hall, which was the concert hall of the time, by the Daughters of the American Revolution. They've asked me very often to stop saying that, but I never shall. Somehow, Eleanor Roosevelt found out about this and decided, okay, we'll do something else. So instead of singing for a few thousand people in Constitution Hall on that Sunday, Marian Anderson sang for tens of thousands of people. And because she wasn't a person to hold a grudge, she wasn't a person to do anything except allow her voice to speak, there were many things that she might have said or might have done on that beautiful morning. But she allowed her voice simply to say, My country, 'tis of thee, sweet land of liberty. That was the first thing that she sang in the concert.
It's extraordinary, no?
It is.
Because one could imagine such bitterness.
Yes, but she was never bitter. I allowed myself at some point to ask her, because one of the things, as a very young child reading that biography, there's one passage in the biography where she needs to have her dress prepared for the performance. And wherever she was staying, the people couldn't be bothered to help her. And so she had to press her own performance dress kind of in the back garden of the hotel or something. I mean, it was really very, very disturbing for me to read that. And At some point, when I thought that it was okay to ask that question, and she said, oh, it didn't mean anything. It simply meant that I was just taking care of this dress. It had been given to me by someone, she mentioned. And so I was taking care of it myself. It was all right. It was fine.
Did you feel she felt otherwise?
No, I did not. I truly did not. I didn't think that she was saying that so that I would feel better or to sort of just get it out of the way. No, I truly felt that she thought, well, that's the way life worked at that moment. And she was going to simply do what needed to be done. And that was something very good to learn at a very young age, that the people that are coming to hear us perform, I'm sure Gilberto feels the same way, they don't care about the stories behind the stage, neither should they. They're coming to hear a performance, and that's what they should be given. And all of the dramatics that might have happened beforehand are interesting and sometimes difficult for those of us. But the audience should get the performance.
We have to listen to a little bit of Marian Anderson. Let's listen to track number one.
Imagine sort of being at my next door neighbor's house, listening to her hi-fi, and listening to that at about age 9, trying to figure out what in the world. I mean, it still touches me in the same way. It's amazing, isn't it?
It's,
truly, truly, truly.
Susan.
Good gracious.
No, continue.
No,
that trick won't work.
No.
So, to come back to your hometown, and I was trying to mention the role your sister has now at the Mount Calvary.
Oh, yes, but that was a long time ago. I think you're talking about something that was on CBS years ago when she was still a student and conducting the choir at the church, but she's not doing that anymore. No. She was my sister. We call my sister the Three Degrees. First, she got a Bachelor of Science, and then she couldn't figure out what she wanted to do with that. And then she decided to get an MBA, and then she decided she didn't like being a business person. So then she went to medical school to be a nurse. So now she's a director of nursing. So that's what she
and
does.
But
she still sings in the choir.
In that choir?
No. She lives in Dallas now.
Augusta has another very famous singer that mattered to you greatly, and I'd like us to listen to track 6 if we could.
I lost someone, my love, someone who's greater than a star, but someone who I need. Someone who don't let my heart bleed.
James Brown.
James Brown.
How old were you when you heard him?
Oh, gosh, I don't remember. I traveled.
Did you meet?
First grade or something, you know, sort of at the school. Well, the thing is, I must tell you a story about meeting James Brown because it is quite unbelievable. More than 15 years ago, because he's been gone for a while. But I was in Augusta to do something or the other, and I'd had a meeting at a hotel. And I was coming out of the meeting and sort of rushing out of the door, generally, is always rushing, going to something else. And there was James Brown. I thought, well, I must speak. I can't just walk past James Brown. So I walked over and I said, hello. And he said, hi, Jess. And I said, somebody must have told him. And so I said, James Brown, how in the world? He says, I know all my homegirls, don't you worry. Can you believe that? I have to tell you, my nephew was very impressed. Oh, yeah, oh, yeah. My star went up a great deal that day. But it was really quite a wonderful thing, and to just have a chance to talk to him a little bit, and he wanted to know, you know, where I was living and how it was all going. And I thought that was just marvelous. There was no reason for me to think that James Brown had the faintest idea that I shared the planet.
I'm one more early influence that you mentioned a while ago. Let's listen, if we could, to track number 4.
Sometimes I feel like a motherless child. Sometimes
Odetta.
My goodness. I love to sing some of the music that she sang, and I love to tell particularly my European audiences, and I feel I need to do this a bit more in the States too, because too many kids nowadays have a faint idea who she was or what she did. But I think the one of the things that tells you exactly the impact that she had on the world while she was in it is that at the time that she was given by President Clinton the National Medal of Arts, he said to her that she was able to prove that music and a person's music could change the hearts and minds of people. That is what he said to Odetta when he gave her the National Medal of the Arts. And it really is something that we probably need to remember more today than ever. That with the arts, it is our, very often our responsibility to share what it is we consider to be our gifts and to use those gifts to change the hearts and minds of people, to broaden minds, our own, as well as those of those we would like to help to have a different view, perhaps, of the world.
How do the arts do that? I mean, do it.
First of all, we need to have as many people as possible participate in, as I was saying before, to live artfully without even trying. I mean, you don't have to have a particular talent. You can do something as simple as keeping a diary, to decide that every day, at a certain time of day or night or morning, whatever, that you're going to sit down and write about your day. That is art. Or that it doesn't matter that you're 45 and you've never studied dance before. There are lots of places, particularly in this city, where you can go and study dance and study with people that are the same level of participation as you are, so that you don't feel, you know, too uncomfortable. But those things, I think, are very important. The self-awareness first, helps us to understand that that other person across from us has that same thing. I love it. Being, for instance, in Thailand, and it's so beautiful. Imagine this. Little children, sort of dressed in blue and white, sort of getting ready to go to school. Imagine someone about sort of this tall, greeting a person about the same size, and they put their hands together and bow. And what that means is that my good spirit greets the good spirit inside of you. If only we could feel that way, if only we could be that way with one another. But I really do feel that if we allow ourselves some form of art, whether it's writing or painting or movement or singing or playing an instrument or whatever it is that we can do, if we understand that we have that inside of us, then it must be that everybody else does too. So how can you dislike that person just because that person looks differently from you? Because that person has that same spirit that you have. So it makes it a little bit more difficult to hate. It makes it a little bit more difficult to be intolerant. It helps you to understand that humanness is what we share and that we must share. Otherwise, I don't know what's going to happen to us.
Thank you. You found it important to go back to what you call your heritage, your inheritance, mm-hmm. your legacy, mm-hmm. what runs, one might say, deeply in your veins, mm-hmm. what's natural to you. And you said this amazing comment, I wasn't born Austrian, I wasn't born German, my roots are from Africa.
Yes.
And you said also there's more memory inside of me for the spiritual tradition of Negro music than perhaps for most of the European music that I sing, because this music was sung by my mother and grandmother and great-grandmother and all of the other people that have made me.
Yes, like and they have made
yeah.
me.
How so? And I would like you to comment on this. Why this urge, I mean, to on the one hand, yes, of course you've studied Schubert, yes, of course you've studied Brahms, yes, of course you've studied and performed Wagner and so many other great
yes.
European musicians.
And I don't sing in a language that I don't speak. No?
No.
Jamais.
Jamais.
No.
So it's I mean, to change the subject for a second,
yes.
but I want to come back to the subject at hand.
Yes.
It's important to understand what one sings.
Well, as I always say to young singers, as musicians, we have yet another level of responsibility. We have words. And it's rather important that they should be understood. And if we don't understand them, it is very difficult to make that person sitting in the last row of the family circle, who is actually in another town, understand what it is we're doing. And I really believe and I insist that if we as singers are doing what we're supposed to do, meaning that we know precisely what we are singing at every point, we know what is the modifier, what is the verb, what is the noun, what all of the words mean, and all of that, that the audience need not speak that language in which we're singing in order to understand what it is about which we are singing. And if we're doing our jobs properly, it should not be necessary to have the little words across the screen. But too many of us choose not to take the words as seriously as I would like.
And to, Yeah.
And I have to, it's very funny, I have to say this, because I was working with some singers, and I had a person say a very surprising thing to me, and I repeat it because it's still, even after 3 years, it's still a mysterious thing to have heard. She, and I was talking to her about the text and why we needed to work on that and to work on the language and so on. And she said, "Yes, I understand that you are a text-based singer." So I said, so that we could move on in our lesson, "Oh, I didn't know there was another kind. Thank you." Yeah.
This does bring me back to the heritage.
Yes.
And in a very simple way, these words that run, that you were saying, in,
yes.
You particularly like singing in Vienna. You like singing in Europe.
Yes.
Because they mean something universally. And they mean something universally, but they also mean something very,
very personally, yes.
And particularly.
But I have to tell you that when I have the opportunity to sing American music and spirituals, that all over the world, it doesn't matter in what country I happen to be. If I present a program and for some reason a spiritual isn't sort of included, at least as a part of the program or as an encore, someone will come to the foot of the stage before I leave the stage and say, "But you have to please sing a spiritual." And you know, it was the Brahms year or the Schubert year or something. I sort of done a whole concert of Schubert. And I thought we'd done pretty well. And somebody comes to the stage and says, "Could you sing a spiritual, please?" And I understand, and I do it as often as I can. And it really is remarkable to me that this music, because of Roland Hayes and Robert McFerrin, Bobby McFerrin's papa, grandfather, and Marian Anderson and Matilda Dobbs and all of these people, the Fisk Jubilee singers who were the first choir to take spirituals out of the country to Europe and so on, that these songs are a part of the fabric of the world, not just the American fabric. The tapestry is very big, and it encompasses the world, and it is so wonderful to sing in Korea and to sing a spiritual and look out into the audience and somebody is mouthing the words with me. It's a beautiful thing to experience.
You have had all these extraordinary mentors in your life. Yes, 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 it will
be quiet.
Come, it will come. That would have been too obvious. Okay,
has to be a little bit more subtle.
Yeah, just a little bit of patience and some fortitude, I promise you. I will do everything in my ability to make this happen. But before I do, there have been incredible guides, mentors, whether it's Karajan or Böhm or others who have mattered to you greatly. But you have also, in this particular program, mentored a singer.
Yes.
And I'd love you to talk a little bit about that and how, here we are doing these evenings and afternoons, but what happens during that year where you and your protégée,
Susan Platz, what a beautiful mezzo-soprano this is. What a beautiful voice, what a gift. I had the opportunity there were a number of singers that wanted to work, and I had friends of mine whose judgment I trust, various people in the world of music and theater and so on, to listen to a great number of singers. And I had the opportunity then to listen to 8 of them and to talk with them and to try to figure out with whom I felt I would be able to do some good. And it was apparent to me in speaking with Susan that first of all, she was serious, that she was focused, and that she understood the idea of actually working to make something better, and not in a superficial way, but to go very deeply into this thing that we call singing, to find out how to do it and to make it mean something to the people that would come and listen to us. And so it was very clear, the person with whom I wished to work. And because this was 2005, 2006, and because I do feel very strongly about her gifts and talent, even though the mentor-protégé thing for us is long since gone, we still work together because we like it.
You've spoken rather beautifully about choosing your roles, mm-hmm. and how important it is to choose the role.
Yes, rather than have them to choose you.
Right. And José Van Damme, who we'll be speaking to tomorrow, said, you build a great career as much on the roles you turn down as on the roles you take on.
Absolutely. And he's absolutely right. What a wonderful thing to have said. I've never put it quite like that, but I quite agree with that articulation of the thing that can happen to a young singer. I had the good fortune of having an artistic director of a Berlin opera company to hear me here in the States and decide that I would be invited to come to sing a debut at his opera house. And it happened that I sang the second aria of Elisabeth and Tannhäuser at this particular gathering of singers. And for those of you that are familiar with Tannhäuser, the character of Elisabeth comes into the opera in the second act, sort of after Venus and all of that in the first act. And she comes in the second act with a very big aria, Dich teuer Halle, and it's a beautiful aria. But it is not as difficult as the aria that comes in the third act. And my teacher at the time, Alice Duschak, at the Peabody Conservatory, had said, if you can learn to sing this aria, then the other one will be much simpler for you, and it will be much better for you to be able to show that you can sing this Allmächtige Jungfrau instead of singing Die Treue Halle, which is a much more obvious thing to sing in a contest, because it requires a very steady breath control. It is very slow, and you're only accompanied by the brass of the orchestra. So there's nobody doubling you, there's nobody sort of covering those things that don't quite work properly. And you are quite exposed. And I sang this aria, and this particular artistic director heard me, Egon Seefelder, and he came to me afterwards and he said, do you know the rest of the opera? I said, well, no. I was 22, I think. And he said, are you prepared to learn it? I said, I could learn it next week. And I really meant it. I mean, there's not a lot on the hard drive at 22. We know that. But he said, it doesn't need to be quite that quick. So 6 months later, I found myself in Berlin singing this entire opera, which of course I had learned backwards and forwards, up and down and all the rest of it. And because I did not wish to make a fool of myself, I had actually gone to Duke University to study German language. I was not going to go to Berlin and not be able to talk to my colleagues. It simply wasn't going to happen. I didn't know that everybody in the world speaks English all over the world. How should I know that? So I studied German also for 5 months. And so when I went along, I could say Guten Morgen, Guten Tag, and all of the rest of it. And it's quite, because it sounds like a fairy tale, I have to tell it. Venus and Tannhäuser do the first act. Then the second act comes the character that I sing, Elisabeth. Egon Seefelder came into my dressing room after the second act of the opera. Now, we still had the third act to go. There's still a lot going on. And he said, this is going very well. I'd like to offer you a contract for 4 years. And I said, but Herr Seefelder, I still have to sing the third act. He said, I heard you sing that aria in New York, you know it, you're fine. And he actually offered me a contract that night. And I said I couldn't sign it because my papa said that I mustn't sign anything that I can't read. And who can read sort of English legalese, much less German legalese? So along I went to the American mission, the consulate, the next day to make sure that I understood everything. And I signed the contract.
And
it's ridiculous.
Trust also.
Trust, absolutely. And there were many occasions when I was offered roles for which I knew in my soul were not things that I should sing. Imagine being 24 and being offered the role of Kundry and Parsifal in a new production. I said, well, thank you, but no. And thank goodness I said, thank you, but no.
Otherwise?
I could never have survived it. There was nothing in my experience at that time that would have had me to live through that experience. My voice simply wasn't ready for it.
There's this line I very much love where you say, I wouldn't for a moment think that singing only happens on earth.
Oh, I'm certain that it doesn't.
The Rumis talk about the music of the spheres.
Yes.
I believe in that. Why would we be the only planet that has singing? I would like to feel that there's music on Jupiter.
Everywhere. Why not? I mean, haven't you ever been, just in Central Park, you don't have to go all the way to the rainforest to sort of hear this sort of thing, but just to be in nature and to listen to the sounds. If that isn't music, I don't know what it is. Whether it's squirrels moving about or the wind through the leaves and the trees or whatever, it's music and it's wonderful.
As we close slowly and arrive to this moment that many people have waited for, You say, for my own burial, I would like the music of Fauré, the music of Bach, the one or two lesser known songs of Schubert. I wonder which those are.
Süße heilige Natur, lass uns gehen nach deiner Spur, leite mich an deine Hand. Wie ein Kind am Gängelband, wie ein Kind am Gängelband. It has the simplicity of a hymn.
And one or two songs that I sang as a very young child, one of which is God Will Take Care of You.
I'm not certain I know the words.
But why don't you leave us on what everybody, even in Vienna after a Schubert concert, asks you to sing. Just leave us on one joyous melody that you feel everybody has to hear tonight.
He's got the whole world in his hands. He's got the whole wide world in his hands. He's got the whole world in his hands. He's got the whole world in his hands. He's got you and me in his hands. He's got you and me in his hands. He's got you and me in his hands. He's got the whole world in his hands. He's got everybody in his hands. He's got everybody in his hands. He's got everybody in his hands. He's got the whole world in his hands.
Jessye Norman. Ha ha ha.